Robert's working practice was very erratic, but when he did come, you know, he'd come for sort of 4 or 5 nights and get a lot done. And on one of the early ones he came. Oh, I should say that I actually had it all lined in canvas and primed. And it was a glorious moment, it was all white. It was like being inside a wedding cake, no cake. It was just gorgeous. Well, on one of the early trips he came, it was all white, and he had a big brush and marked out major statements all over the place. And it looked hideous. As years went by, it became more and more like ghastly psychedelic rock punk. Bits taking incongruous things together and together. And then he came, I've forgotten when, but the whole thing got pulled together in one 10-day session. But what else? He called it the riddle mural. I don't know if he's talking English or rubbish, but there are sort of clues, in a certain sense, to God knows what. But sort of philosophical things and aesthetics and goodness knows what. But there are lots and lots and lots and lots of drawings, all of them covered in notes and writing, and small supply of writing, explaining his ideas about garden, romantic love, the Holocaust. This whole image here is a Holocaust image. And it's in the form of a dragon. Magnolia is coming.
Oh, yeah.
And it's, the tail is made of hooks and it's thrashing around. And that sort of big, pale, triangular section partly just the wing. And he represents the sum of human knowledge, that dragon, and brings with him just the chaos and madness with it. It distills new beauty, and then it comes out of the dragon, according to Robert. And over there, there's another dragon. And she starts off being all sort of alluring and soft. Those materials are extremely competently painted and sensual and feminine. And then her tail changes. And it's in a sort of, starts with a sort of cliched domesticity, domestic kind of scenes. His tail, too, the dragon's tail here, there's books at the top of the window. And the tail changes into the greenery of the flowers. Her tail, going back to her tail. According to Robert. Those items represent inflexible and brittle nature and uncompromising ways of living. But it's all pressed up. Looks like that. What actually goes on, you can't see it because it's bad. It's at the bottom of all these angels. There's a bound, brutal expression. Not exactly that. But they're damaged. Romantic love there, and some violent rape scene that way. Anyway, that's the dragons. And the whole of this side actually represents unrequited love, death, insanity, chaos, and violence, which is diametrically opposite to this side. But I haven't finished this side. It's a death side. Now up here, there are two other images, separate pictures in their own rights. One, and not finished. A lot of it's not finished. All this splodge stuff was all going to be sort of with a stained rag or sort of tidied up and blended in to make it all the hero. And there was going to be more and more people as time went by. And on this side, there's basically the descent of the angels. And it was painted on scaffold with a small piece of paper about piece of housewriting, my housewriting paper, sort of overish. And he cut out a sort of abstract figure and bent it with a little power. And then dropping into a seven-headed dragon red tongue. And actually, he painted that from, there's a little model on the desk there in that room. Johnny, yes, passion, friendship, hope. And it was, it was going to be 12 women sitting at a table eating a feast. That's why I respected the women's feast. And the leading lady is A.O. Rouse, and he really liked that. and then behind it, there's trees that look as though they survived the First World War. They would have gone up. And you see how it's dark where the falling angels start. And it's dark over the fireplace. There was going to be a dark, they were going to be connected with a dark stain. So there's just this pool, this pastel pool inside it, which has perspective in it, because nowhere else is there any perspective. And that's a sort of composite view of the estate of the garden.
And then
there's Moses, Robert went to Rome. That was done from postcard size. And then there's a picture of the house right behind Moses' head. And then the next bit is heavenly mansions, really. It's a sort of soaring tower of just beautiful, beautiful buildings just spearing upwards and onwards in all directions, filled with those figures come from various carvings, religious, Christian, or carvings in Europe that represent hope and faith and love. And there's just, you're just looking at sort of three floors of this great soaring, and up at the top there's angel of faith coming from the earth. Like that. And that's about it, really. Any question? I mean, it's 30 years, and those little boys, that smallest little boy, I think it's probably two. It's probably about 90 days, I reckon, of work here, well, in the room.
Would you leave it unfinished, or would you?
I
didn't know whether Wolf would finish it.
Well, there would be some point in joining that dark stain up across the top there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that you've got the full effect of this lyrical and beautiful scene there. Not finished in any more detail at all, just to stain it so that from Robert's drawings and notes, it's obvious what he had intended. I could consider that, yes. It would be valid. Depending on how well the sale goes next week, I might just cut it up into pieces. But it's on the site of the abbot's dormitory when this was a monastery, and it's a very ancient monastery. But the room was built in about 1702, I think, early 1700s. And then at the end of that 18th century, Soane, the architect, John Soane, came and altered the proportions by raising the ceiling. He raised the whole ceiling to nearly 3 foot, nearly 4 foot, and put this railing in. Previously, the windows had been right to the floor, and the ceiling right to the top of the windows. It was kind of like being the snare drum. And he made design the ceiling. Yeah, I found somebody's house in the mansion. The carpet, made the room. It's brown, things are called in. And that thing was in the right pavilion. So that's it. Saying you're just the most common.
in sympathy with the...
Yes, it's the right colour, isn't it? And it's the right scale for the room.